Listen.
This call is now being recorded.
So, hello sir, I am audible.
Yes sir, you are audible. Welcome screen नहीं आ रहा है sir, please share the welcome screen.
Yes.
Yes, now it's visible.
Okay sir. So at the outside, on the hop of Department of Electrical Engineering of Tulsiramji Gaikwad Patil College of Engineering and Technology, I welcome our today's experts, Dr. Nitin D. Ghaugave sir, Professor and Head of Department of Electrical Engineering, Government College of Engineering, Nagpur. So for the AICT sponsored Prerna scheme in expert series lecture. And today we discuss the easy tricks for the topics of digital electronics and microprocessor. So our honorable expert of today's session has Dr. Nitin Ghaugave sir has an experience more than 30 years in engineering background, and his and sir has guided many students in UG as well as PG, also in PhD thesis. Sir has published various paper in national and international journal of repute. So without wasting time, I hand over the session to the expert Dr. Nitin Ghaugave sir. So Ghaugave sir, start the session sir.
Yes, okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Is my voice clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, good afternoon, one and all. Professor Shah sir, Professor Chetan Jambulkar sir, all faculty and dear students of Tulsiramji Gaikwad Patil College of Engineering. It's my pleasure to be here to deliver this session on digital electronics and microprocessors. Basically, I will be dividing this session in two parts. When we talk about digital electronics, it's a vast topic, but definitely I will try to cover few of the important say digital blocks I will say, or digital circuits in detail. We are not going to discuss them in detail, but definitely the basic blocks of digital which are available in digital electronics, such as flip-flops, counters, registers, etc. Then second part will be the introduction to microprocessor 8085. And if the time is available, I will try to cover the memory also, how memory is interfaced with the microprocessor 8085. Time is very short because in 1.5 hours I am supposed to cover these many things. So I will start with the basics of digital electronics. I will share my screen. Can you see the screen? This whiteboard? Hello? Please respond to me.
Yes, sir.
Okay, can you see the whiteboard? Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir. Students are replying in the chat box, sir.
Can you see this gate? Which is this gate? No one? Hello? Am I audible?
Hello, students. Please give the response on mic. So it is most preferable.
Students are there.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So can you answer this question? Which is this gate I have drawn?
AND gate.
Which is the logic? No one? Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So I have drawn something on this page. So what is it? Is it a gate or not? What are the types of gates? Anyone, any, at least you tell me that, okay, you know something about it. Any one of the gates, logic gates?
AND gate, sir.
What are the various types of gates? Logic gate. No one? One gate I write over here, OR gate. Do you remember now? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
At least you write in the chat box. I just go to the chat box. Yes. Can you write in the chat box? AND gate, okay. AND not, all right. All right, few of you have written, you have mentioned something. Okay, thank you. Well, coming back. So whatever the gate I have drawn here, it is AND gate, right? Now, there are various gates with each other and a logical circuit can be formed. This is the symbol, the gate which I have drawn, it is AND gate. This is OR gate, right? Here y is equal to a dot b, y is equal to a or b, Now for AND gate. Hello. Can you see the screen now? Hello? Ambulkar,
yes, sir?
Sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So there are various gates I have drawn over here. AND gate, OR gate, NOT, NAND, and NOR. Is that clear? Can you see these five gates on this screen? I hope you can see.
Yes, sir. Yes.
All the time I cannot go to the chat box. But definitely from my mobile I can just join it again. You can answer to me.
So every student are requested to mic on and answer this question to the sir.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, sir.
Yes. Please go ahead. Bola. Well, shall we move ahead?
Yes, sir.
Now I am erasing this image. Okay. It has gone now. Please respond yes or no. Is it erased?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So various images which I had drawn, they are now removed. I am going further. Another important block in digital electronics is the what is flip-flop? The basic flip-flop is RS flip-flop. Okay. RS are the inputs, Y and Y bar are the outputs. Can you see this flip-flop? Yes or no? Hello?
No, sir.
Okay. So I have drawn here this RS flip-flop. What is the speciality of this flip-flop? When S and R both are zero, both Y and Y bar will have the last values. When S is 1, R 0, Y is always equal to 1 and Y bar will be 0. When S is 0, R is 1, Y bar will be 0 and Y will be 0 and Y bar will be 1. And when both are 1, that we call it as the forbidden condition, that not allowed, forbidden. Okay. Forbidden condition. So this is the basic flip-flop. In fact, entire digital electronics is divided into two parts, two types of circuits. Number one, the combinational logic circuits, and another, second, is the sequential logic circuits. In combinational logic circuits, we can take the simple example of gates. Okay. Gates are the best examples of combinational logic circuits. Other combinational circuits are multiplexer, demultiplexer, decoder, encoder, etc. Okay. Whereas sequential logic circuit, when we talk about sequential logic circuits, flip-flops, counters, registers, all these are the sequential logic circuits. Is that clear? So this is the basic flip-flop which I have drawn over here. Further, it can be modified to clock arrays. Clock arrays. In clock arrays, there is an additional input, that is clock terminal. Okay. So this is the clock input. We can name it as CK. So how many inputs are there now? Three. S, R, and clock. What is the importance of this clock input? Clock must be one, so as to operate this flip-flop as a simple RS flip-flop. The flip-flop will operate, that means whatever the logical level that will be getting over here, okay, all they will be according to the basic RS flip-flop. When clock is one, there are four conditions of clock. When RS can be 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1 and 1, 1. So for all these four conditions, the flip-flop will work as a normal RS flip-flop. Is that clear? But when clock is zero, okay, again there will be four conditions. See, one thing you have to remember always, depending upon the number of inputs, there can be number of output combinations. If there are three inputs, total possible output combinations would be eight. If there are two inputs, total output combinations will be four, and so on. So here there are three inputs, so naturally there should have been eight combinations, eight output combinations. Okay, so four combinations we have seen for clock equal to one. Another four combinations will be for clock equal to zero. Now when clock equal to zero, what happens to outputs? That we will see. Clock equal to zero. When clock equal to zero, the flip-flop is disabled. In short, Y and Y bar will have lost values. Okay, for all these four conditions, Y and Y bar will have last values or initial values. If initially Y equal to 1 and Y bar equal to 0, there is no change in these values. Meaning of it is like this. Okay. When clock is 0, Y and Y bar will remain 1, 0 for all the conditions. If you assume Y and Y bar as 1, 0, it will remain 1, 0 for all. Okay. Getting it or not? Yes or no? I will not go into the detailed circuit, okay, because it will take again much more time. I am just skipping so many things. Well, so this is what about clock arrays. I will go to B flip-flop, which is an important flip-flop. Clock and D and Y. We will not take Y bar because when Y is 0, Y bar is assumed always to be 1 or vice versa. Okay, so I will not show Y bar there, but you have to assume it to be. There is no question of assumption, but as far as explanation is concerned, you have to see it. Practically, it is proved that when Y is 0, Y bar is always 1. And when Y is 1, Y bar is always 0. Okay, so let us discuss these four conditions. I just remove this again. First of all, I draw the flip-flop. What is D flip-flop? D flip-flop is the modification of clock RS. When an inverter is connected between S and R, and if the common input is termed as, called as D, is represented as D. This is D is basically S input of clock RS, okay, with one inverter is connected between S and R, okay, internally that arrangement is made there, okay. Or okay, I will just show it. Well, you know clock. This is clock. This is S R, and this is Y. No Y bar. Now when and inverter is connected between S and R. This is your clock input. Okay. So the flip-flop becomes D. Now this arrangement is actually internal arrangement. S and R are internally connected with each other through an inverter or NOT gate. And then this input can be represented as D. There is only one D input. What is the speciality? What is the difference between clock RS and D then? The forbidden condition is avoided. Forbidden condition means when clock is 1, S equal to 1, R equal to 1, Y and Y bar are forbidden. They go in forbidden condition, not allowed or uncertain. It is called as uncertain condition. So this condition is avoided in D flip-flop. Why? Because inverter is connected between S and R. And when S and R, they are joined with this such an inverter, there is no possibility of S, R equal to 1 at a time. Because when S is 1, R will be always 0. Or when S is 0, R will always be 1. So this forbidden condition is avoided in D flip-flop. Okay. So that is the speciality of D flip-flop. It is further modification of RS. Well, so I remove this now. Lock. Okay. Now it is something like this. When, see, there are two possibilities of clock. Clock equal to 0 or clock equal to 1. So when clock equal to 0, there are two possibilities of D for clock equal to 0. Either D can be 0 or D can be 1. Now for this condition, Y will always be unchanged, no change, or last value, no change, NC. No change. Y will have last value, that is no change. Is it clear? When clock equal to 0. It is something like the clock RS flip-flop, just which we have seen just now, that when clock is 0, there is no effect on Y and Y bar values. If irrespective of inputs, here also in D flip-flop, irrespective of the D value, y will remain unchanged. Okay, last value. Now, when clock is 1, again there will be two possibilities of d. D equal to 0 or d equal to 1. Now, as soon as the clock is made 1, what happens? Whatever the value of d that is transferred, that is stored in this D flip flop. Okay, so if d is 0, y will also be 0. If d is 1, y will also be 1. Whatever is d, d can be either 0 or 1. There are two possibilities, but this is possible. This transfer action will be possible when clock is 1. Is that clear? So this is very important thing that you must note, because this is the basic, say you can call it as a cell, basic cell of a memory. Okay, 1-bit memory cell, you can represent it as 1 bit of data can be stored or into or stored out, read out from this D flip flop. Okay, but for that, what we need is to make the clock equal to 1. Okay, all right, getting it or not? Am I clear? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So we have seen D flip flop, then RS. There are other flip flops also, JK, JK master slave. Okay, and JK master slave flip flop is assumed as it is considered as a basic block of counters. JK master slave flip flop operating in a toggling condition, when J and K both are 1, the output toggles between 0 and 1. But when the clock goes low, at all falling edges of the clock, the output changes to 0. It will change from 1 to 0 or 0 to 1. When clock edges are changing from 1 to 0, at all those falling edges, the flip-flop output will change. Okay, so that is what the counter. I just remove this. In counter, what we do, if this is JK master slave flip flop operating in a toggling condition, this is the clock. Output responds to the falling edge of the clock. That's why this dot is shown, bubble dot is shown. Now, when JK both are 1, we represent it as a toggling condition. Okay. So, initially, if Y is equal to 0, if initially y is equal to 0, at every falling edge, so I draw here the clock pulses. These are the various clock pulses which are applied over here. Now, I just draw output. So when y is plotted here, initially suppose y is equal to 0. See, we have to consider all these falling edges of the clock. Okay. Initially, I just take the different pen, say this one, okay. Right, this y will change to 1, it will remain 1 till there is change in the clock. Here again clock changes from 1 to 0, so y will change to 0. Okay, here another falling edge of the clock. So at this falling edge, y will change to 1. Y will change to 1. Again it will change to 0. In this way, y will change between 0 and 1 at every falling edge of the clock. All these are the falling edges. Falling edge means what? The clock changes from 1 to 0, and depending upon the size of counter, we can count those very number of clock pulses. For example, this is a single flip-flop, JKMS flip-flop, so it can count only 2 states. One JK flip-flop can count 2 clock states, clock pulses, not states. Okay. The first clock pulse and the second clock pulse. What are those states? One is 0 state of output, another is 1 state. Okay. If you apply third clock pulse, what will happen? Again, 0 state will arrive. Okay. So if you write the truth table like this, clock. Clock, then y, 0th clock, no clock pulse is arrived, y remains 0. The first clock pulse is arrived, y becomes 1. When second clock pulse is arrived and it goes low, again y becomes 0. Third, again it becomes 1. So how many states are counted? 0 and 1. Because these states are repeated again. Okay. How many clock pulses we have to apply? If you count from this first and second, or 0th and first. So after 2 clock pulses, the original state is obtained. Okay. So for this is for the 2-bit counter, sorry, a single bit counter. There are 2 states. If you consider 2-bit counter, the output states will be like this, y1 and y0. What are the states? 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Okay, so the first state, second, third and fourth. Naturally, this particular counter, 2-bit counter, this is 2-bit. Okay, 2-bit counter. It can count 4 states. If you consider 3-bit, how many states will be counted? Yes. Or 3-bit counter, how many states? Can you hear me? Please answer my question. Hello. Hello. Can you hear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So my question is for 3-bit binary counter. How many states will be counted? Number of states. Answer orally without in the chat box. Don't write in chat box because it is not available now. Yes.
Eight.
Yes, correct. 8 states means n-bit binary counter in general, n-bit binary counter can count 2 to the power n states. If n is equal to 3, 2 raised to 3 means 8. If n is equal to 4, 2 to the power 4 means 16. 16 states will be counted for 4-bit binary counter. For 5-bit, 2 to the power 5, that means 32 states or 32 clock pulses will be counted. Okay? So, in this way, the number of states will be counted by these counters. This is an important block of digital electronics. Another important block is the register. Register is to store again some data, shifting the data from, there are various registers, in fact serial in, serial out, shift register, serial in, parallel out, parallel in, serial out, and parallel in, parallel out, shift register. Okay, these are the various registers. All these are the sequential logic circuits. Okay. Then coming to combinational logic, some basic gates we have seen, all these are the combinational logic circuits. Now the circuit which I am drawing over here, for example this, is MUX. MUX means what? It's a multiplexer. 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 What do you mean by multiplexing? Many into one. There are many things in one, or many into one. You must have visited multiplexed. Okay. Have you seen movie in multiplex? Yes, there are various movie halls in a multiplex. Number of movie halls, just like that. Whichever you want to go, you will have to purchase the ticket and go to the hall, to that movie hall. So, in short, this multiplexer circuit in digital electronics is nothing but the transferring data to from many of the lines to only one line, many into one. There are a number of data lines. For example, this multiplexer circuit, it is having number of data lines or data inputs. So one of the data inputs will be selected at the output. This is the Y output. output line. And of course, this control action, transfer action, is controlled by various control inputs. These are control. Control inputs. Okay, all these are the control inputs. Right. Means applying a particular combination of control inputs, you can select a particular data line and transfer that input to the output. That's all. This is a very simple and simple combinational circuit. Okay. For example, if you consider eight is to one multiplexer. How many data lines will be there? 8. Okay. Say I name these lines as D7 to D0. Okay. And there are 3 control inputs. A2, A1, A0. The combination of A2, A1, A0 can be applied to select a particular data input and to transfer it at the output. Or in short, that particular data input will be selected at the output. Okay. If you apply, say, 110, A2, A1, A0 equal to 110. What will happen with this? Which of the data inputs will be selected at output? Yes. Data at zero or one, D7. See, there are 8 data lines: D7, D6, D5, D4, 3, 2, 1, and 0. Now, out of these 8 data lines, which of the lines will be selected with this combination of control? Anyone? No one. No one out of you. Hello. Are you getting me? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, have you understood my question? If A2, A1, A0 equal to 110, which of the data inputs will be selected at the output? It is so simple. Okay, I will tell. It is D6. Because 110 is equivalent to 6. Getting it? Somewhere here, this is the line of say D4. We want the input at D4 to be transferred to Y. Whatever 0 or 1, it is to be transferred to Y. This is what our requirement. In short, we have to select this D4 line at the output. What should be the combination? Another question. A2, A1, A0 should be equal to what?
100.
Yes, 100, correct. If you apply 100 to A2, A1, A0, this D4 line will be selected at the output. So this is a very simple type of combinational circuit, combinational logic circuit. Reverse of it is demultiplexer. Okay. Demultiplexer is just opposite of multiplexer. In demultiplexer, there is only one data line and number of output lines. Number of output lines. Okay, Y0, Y1, and so on. Right. And various control inputs. Control inputs are there as usual. All these are the control inputs. And these are the data output lines. And there is a single data. Single data line. Okay. Now by applying a combination of these control inputs, the data can be transferred to a particular output line. In multiplexer, what we have seen? There are number of data inputs. And one of the data input is transferred to the output. That's all. Whereas in demultiplexer, there is only one data and that data is transferred to one of the output lines. Okay, maybe Y0, Y1, Y2, whatever. Okay, for example, if you consider this is, say, 1, 2, 8. Demultiplexer. So whatever the data, it will be transferred to these 8 output lines. क्लास शुरू है क्लास सो देर आर डिफरेंट कंट्रोल इनपुट्स राइट एंड बाय अप्लाइंग ए कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ दिस कंट्रोल इनपुट्स डेटा कैन बी ट्रांसफर टू आउटपुट लाइन्स ओके सपोज अवर नीड इज सी दिस इज Y7 Y6 and so on up to Y0. Alright, Y7, Y6 up to Y0. These are the output lines and suppose we want input to the Y5 line. Input is to be transferred to Y5. This is what our requirement. What should be the control input? Of course, there should be 3. 1 is to 8. Means what? There are 8 output lines. Means only you need 3 control inputs. A2, A1, A0. The same principle. If number of control input is N, n is the number of control inputs, 2 to the power n output lines can be available, right? So again I come to my question, this Wi-Fi U, suppose you want to transfer this data to Wi-Fi U output line, what should be the combination of A2, A1, A0? Again, can anybody tell me?
101.
Oh, sorry. Yes.
101, sir.
101, correct. 101. All right. 101. Okay, so Wi-Fi U will be selected. Okay, data will be transferred to Wi-Fi U line. So in this way, this demultiplexer action is taken place. So this is all about multiplexer and demultiplexer. Now I come to our basics of microprocessor, which is our topic of discussion today. Okay, shall I start? Shall I go to microprocessor, or you have any difficulties, doubts about digital electronics? Because everything cannot be possible to cover. There are so many things to be studied. But I suppose you have already studied digital electronics. I just brushed it up. Is that clear? Shall I switch over to microprocessor? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Introduction to microprocessor architecture using Intel 8085. So, what is microprocessor? It's a silicon chip that contains a central processing unit. Before I proceed to microprocessor, let me tell you one thing. That every computer system, whether it is there, every computer system is consisting of these four blocks: the central processing unit, input device, output device, and memory. Any computer, whether it is microcomputer, whether it is mini computer, mainframe, or supercomputer, every computer system is consisting of these four blocks. Is that clear? And we have to focus upon the CPU, and that too the microprocessor. Microprocessor, which we are going to study now, is a central processing unit. That's all. Of course, it is interfaced with the input, it is interfaced with the output device, memory, etc. But what is the internal architecture of microprocessor and all that, that we will try to cover within next 45 minutes. Okay. So every computer system is consisting of these four blocks. Just going back. So it's a silicon chip that contains a central processing unit. In the world of personal computers, these are alternately used, microprocessor or CPU. At the heart of all PCs, personal computers, the most workstation sits as a microprocessor. Also controls the logic of almost all the digital devices, the processing of various instructions and all that. All these things, all these operations, they are being performed by the microprocessor. Now, in general computer system, as I said, that there is a central processing unit. Okay, this is a common name, right? But when you talk about microcomputer, you will have to use microprocessor word. In fact, microprocessor is basically CPU, as I told you. So, microprocessor is nothing but the central processing unit. It's a programmable device. It can be instructed to perform the given tasks within its capability. The programmer selects instructions from the list and determines the sequence of execution. In fact, what is a program? Program is nothing but a set of instructions to perform a particular task, right? And these instructions, which are written in a particular sequence, that is nothing but the program, of course. But how these instructions are executed? If you want to execute the entire program, every individual instruction will have to be executed independently. Remember, complete task, complete objective of the program. If you want to achieve it, if you want to complete that task, every instruction of the program must be executed independently. Okay, so it takes input from the input device and processes the input as it behaves like CPU and gives the output. Okay, it's a clock driven semiconductor device consisting of electronic logic circuits manufactured using LSI or VLSI technique. Okay, very large scale integrated technique circuits are there. They are embedded in a single chip. Around lakhs of circuits are embedded in a single chip, and these circuits are nothing but flip flops, registers, gates, and so on, multiplexers, adders, subtractor circuit, etc. In fact, I forgot to tell you while discussing the combinational logic circuits, adder and subtractor, these are also the combinational logic circuits where some arithmetic operations are performed. Okay, well, coming back, microprocessor can be divided into three important segments. Number one, ALU. What is this ALU? ALU stands for Arithmetic and Logic Unit. Okay. ALU stands for Arithmetic and Logic Unit. As the name indicates, some arithmetic and logical operations are performed in ALU. Okay, then there is the register array, there is the control unit. Okay, there is the control unit also. Okay, we were up to this point. And the register array. There are certain registers which store the data. Okay, 8-bit data. This we have already seen. Okay. Characteristics with characteristics with differentiate the microprocessors. These are the various important parameters which make or which allow to classify the various microprocessors. Okay, instruction set is one of the important parameters, bandwidth or clock speed and so on. Perhaps you might have heard the various say processors. 8085 was the basic processor. Then came 8086, then 80286, 386, 486, then came Pentium 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Then came further Core 2 Duo. Okay, there are various processors, okay? But the basic of all these processors is the 8085. It is further expanded depending upon the number of instructions available or bandwidth and so on. For example, if you take a simple 8086 or 8086 and 8085, the basic difference between 8085 and 86 is that 8085 has the capability to transmit the data, 8 bits of data at a time, 8 bit, okay, or bandwidth is 8 bits. Bandwidth for 8085 is 8 bits. At a time, 8 bits of data can be transmitted over the data bus. Whereas in 8086, there are 16 bits which can be transmitted at a time. So naturally, 8086 has better capability for transmitting the data. And of course, the programming capability will also be improved. Further, clock speed. This is also another important parameter. Number of instructions, etc. History of microprocessor. Intel's 4004 is considered the first microprocessor. Further, 4004 was followed in 1972 by 8008, the world's first 8-bit microprocessor. Then came 8080. It was evolved in 1974. Okay, 8080 came in 1974. All these were having limited capability. And then introduced 8085, which is the most popular microprocessor in the world at that time. Okay, and it started in entire industry and various controls have been even nowadays 8085 finds lot of capability in doing so many operations, various controls, various automations in industry and so on. Okay. So 8085 has wide range of applications. It is basically introduced in 1977, around 77. Okay. It is basically 8-bit microprocessor, but having addressing capability of 2 to the power 16 addresses. 65,000 memory locations can be accessed with the help of 8085. What do you mean by data bus and address bus? That we'll see. Basically, these are the two important things which you need to understand: address bus and the data bus. Of course, there is another third bus, that is the control bus, which is also available. So this is something 8085, the chip which looks like 1976, it is mentioned. So it is 76 or 77. Okay, so it's a 40 pin IC, 20 pins on left side, 20 pins on right side. This is the pin configuration. Okay, 1 to 20 pins on left side you can see, and 21 to 40. Now we'll discuss, we'll have a quick look on these various pins. Sorry, just keep it down. Well, so X1, X2, that stands for connecting the crystal. X1, X2 represent the clock. Clock is applied across 1 and 2. Okay, so always remember, the clock which is applied to this 8085 is of around 5 megahertz. Up to 5 megahertz it can be applied. So that the processing capability will be based on this clock speed. Okay, more or higher is the speed of this clock, or higher is the frequency of this clock, higher will be the execution, lower will be the execution time for every instructions. Well, this is not the part of discussion. So X1, X2 stand for applying the clock. Reset out, when this microprocessor is connected to various devices and when it is to be reset. Okay. It gives this pin as high. This pin becomes 1. Okay, when the microprocessor is reset out. Okay. When the microprocessor is reset, this is the output signal which is given by 8085. SOD stands for serial out data. SID is the serial in data. Data can be entered serially and also it can be taken out serially. This is one option. Parallel data can also be, of course, most of the time it is parallel data operation. Right. So serial in data, as the name indicates, it is entered serially, it is taken out serially. Then trap, RST 7.5, 6.5, 5.5 and INTR, INT. All these are the interrupt pins. Interrupt. Interrupt pins, right? Out of these, That means trap 7.5, 6.5, 5.5. These are the hardware interrupts. That means when any one of these signal, any one of these pins go high, automatically the program control is transferred to a particular location. Okay, memory location. In fact, one thing you should remember, that program is always stored in the memory. Okay, program is always stored in the memory. There are so many 65,000 memory locations, something 65,500 something. Okay, these many memory locations, the program programmer can use. Of course, there are assigned for some certain special or some specific task. But rest of the locations, the programmer can use to write the instructions. So always remember, program is stored in the memory, and when such type of interrupts, any of these interrupts go high, the program control is transferred to the particular interrupts. Out of these 6 pins, 4 represent the hardware interrupt pins. Okay, 6, 7, 8, 9, and pin number 10 is a software interrupt. Whenever any of these interrupt pin goes high, interrupt acknowledge is given to the device. For example, if some external device wants the assistance of 8085. For example, this 8085 is interfaced with so many devices. Say one of the devices is a AD converter, analog to digital converter. Okay. Now some analog input is given to this AD converter, and that input is to be converted into digital form, and this AD converter is to be interfaced with the microprocessor, but this has to be done through microprocessor. Some signals are to be sent, this AD converter has to be controlled, start of conversion signal has to be given. See, AD converter chip has different pins. This is a data pins, output digital data, then start of conversion and end of conversion. Okay, then selecting, there is a multiplexer, control inputs. Okay, so selecting a particular channel, right? So start of conversion or something, other controls are to be given from the microprocessor. Of course, while giving the service to this AD conversion, output of this AD converter will have to be given to the one of the interrupts. Okay, then the microprocessor will come to know that, okay, some services are to be given, are required to be given to this AD converter. So it will stop its own programming, and the control will be transferred for AD conversion. Okay, in this way this thing is happened. In fact, it's a very short time to explain all these things, because interrupts require so many things. As a practical example, I will give you. Remember, microprocessor is always busy in doing so many tasks. Okay, but at the same time, it has to give service to external devices also, as like AD conversion or automatic say temperature control of a room. Okay, suppose automatically you want to switch on the air conditioners. Okay, when the temperature goes to a particular level, AC should be turned on. AC, this is a service that is to be given, that is supposed to be given by, say, 8085. This is one example I am telling you. Now, when temperature goes says above a set value, automatically the signal will be generated by the microprocessor. But how this has happened? Because microprocessor is busy. It is already performing certain task. It is executing certain program. And when it receives the signal that the temperature goes above this value, say 30 degrees centigrade or 27 degrees centigrade, immediately what microprocessor will do, it will stop everything. Okay, whatever the program which was executing earlier or prior to this 27 degree centigrade point, this will 8085 will store this program to somewhere else, main program, and it will give services to that air conditioner, switching on condition of the air conditioner, right? But this is happened through interrupt services. Of course, interrupt, there will be interrupt. Interrupt pin goes high, either of this hardware or software interrupt, it goes high, right? When the temperature goes above 27 degree centigrade, either of these lines go high. And microprocessor will come to know, okay, something has to be done, right? So the program for switching on the air conditioner will be performed, or it will be executed. But prior to this, prior to doing this, it was doing some different task. So getting that task again and restoring the operation, all these things will be possible when these various pins are examined. Okay, for example, whenever interrupt is received, interrupt acknowledge signal is given by the 8085 to the device which wants the external service. Okay, so all this is happened with the, I mean, the 8085 is designed in such a way to happen these things, right? Now I was talking about a practical examination, a practical example. Suppose you are reading a book at your home. Okay, you are reading, say, a book, and somewhat you are at, say, page number 100 of that book. You are reading a novel, say, for example, which is consisting of so many pages, say 200 or 300, and you are at 100 number page. Suppose a call bell, there is some outside your home, outside the door, who switches the call bell, rings the call bell. What you will be doing? You will keep some bookmark at the page number 100, because you were at 100 number page. You will keep some bookmark, you will close the book, you will open the door, okay, because someone is outside the door, and suppose there is a parcel or something that is being delivered to you, so you will collect that parcel and again you will come back to your normal position where you were sitting earlier, and again you will start reading. But how will you reach to that page again? You will just pick up that bookmark and open the page number 100 where you were earlier at that page. So this particular service, right, you just compare with the services given by the microprocessor 8085. Okay, so I will not explain much more. Well, moving further, AD0 to AD7. Okay, Yeah, all right. AD0 to AD7. These are the pins. Which represent address and data pins. See, as I told you, 8085 is a 8-bit microprocessor. Meaning of it is that 8 bits of data can be transmitted at a time. 8 bits. Data bus. Okay. Now, these 8 bits data bus represent these bits D0, D1, D2, D3, D4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Data bus is connected to these data pins. All right. But at the same time, these pins are also used to carry address. Okay, address. See, this is the data bus I am drawing over here. Right, data bus D7 to D0. Right, this will be D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D6. Okay. Say, suppose the data is 1 0 1 1 0 0 1 1. This is 8-bit data. So this is available on these data pins. Now it can be transmitted as and when it is required, say in memory or IO device or whatever, input device, output device or what, right? In short, 8 pins are exclusively for data. Also, they are shared with the address pins. As I said, that address bus of 8085 is 16 bits wide. Okay, 16 bits. This is address bus. Okay, this is A0 to A15. The last address is A15, and the first address is A0. The bit is A0. So A0 to A7. Remember, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This up to this address A7, A0 to A7 and A8 to A15. Okay. So, these pins, they are used for data pins sometimes, and they are also used to transmit the address also. Okay, same pins are used to transmit this A0 to A7 address, to hold this A0 to A7 address. Okay. In short, this A0 to A7 these pins of address, they are shared with the data pins. Okay, these are the data pins D0 to D7. So, hello. Yeah. Can you see this IC? 40 pin IC? Hello?
Sir.
Yeah, okay. You got the meaning of this? Data and address pins. Hope you understood it. Then pin number 20 is VSS, that is negative of battery or ground. Positive of battery is VCC. Then 8, A9, A10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. These are the address pins which are exclusively used for addressing purpose. Okay. For higher order address, as I drawn over here, your address bus is 16 bits wide. Okay. A0 to A7, then A8 to A15. Okay. So out of this, A0 to A7 is shared with the data pins. Whereas A7 to A8, they have separate pins available. Okay, in this way, the total addressing capacity using 8085 is 2 to the power 16. Total combinations will be how much? A0 to A15 means how many pins? How many pins are there? 16. Okay. And whenever there are 16 pins available or data pins available, address pins available, what will be the combination? 2 raised to 16. These many combinations can be possible. For example, the first combination will be 0000, okay. Next combination will be 1, all zeros except this one. In this way, the last combination will be 1 1 1 sorry okay 1 1 1 1 1 1 1 1 1 okay, all ones. Right. So in this way, you can have this many total possible combinations with the addresses. Well, coming back to here, S0 is status pin S0 and S1. These are the status pin. They will represent which type of operation is being performed, whether it is writing operation, reading, fetch or halt operation. All right. Then ALE, that is address latch enable, when the address is to be latched while using this bus in a sharing mode, this ALE pin goes high. WR bar, RD bar, these are the pins for writing and reading operation. This should be low. Okay, whenever there is writing operation, this pin will go low, of course. and when reading operation, the pin will go low. RD bar pin will go low. IO/M bar, there is a single pin that is used for input output devices or memory. Okay. Now, if the operation is related with the memory, if the operation is related with memory, IO/M bar it will go low. Now in memory also we can have two types of operations. One is reading operation, another is the writing operation. Now whenever writing operation is to be performed, WR bar should be low. Something, if you want to write something in the memory, WR bar should be low. If you want to read something from the memory, RD bar should be low. In addition to this, this is must. This is also required for writing operation. If there is no writing operation, only reading operation, one is IO/M bar to be zero, another RD bar should be low. Okay, with this you can write you can read something from the memory. Similarly, now I will ask you another question. Suppose this is the situation. What is the indication of it? Yes, when IO/M bar is 1 and RD bar is low. Yes, can you answer it? IO/M bar, hello, can you hear me? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what will you understand from this? IO/M bar is equal to 1. What does it mean? Kya meaning hota hai iska? IO/M bar ye agar 1 hai to iska meaning kya hoga? Yes. Well, I think
input output pin is active, sir.
Yes, it will be.
Input output pin is active.
No, it will be related to IO device or memory. First of all, you tell me.
IO device, sir.
IO device, correct. And we are keeping RD bar equal to 0, means what? Which device will be accessed, input device or output device? Reading kahan se honga? Input device se hota hai, output device se hota hai?
Input device.
Input is correct. Input device is to be read. Theek hai na? Maybe punch card, for example. Punch card is an input device, right? So it is to be read. All right. Or kuch likhna hai, for example, If you want to write something on output device, such as a printer, right? You will have to again keep I oblique M bar equal to 1, but instead of RD bar, it will be what? It will be WR bar. WR bar, why I am saying this bar? Bar represents that it is active low. M bar is active low. IO, there is no bar, means it is active high. This particular pin, if it is 1, meaning of it is that IO will be selected. If it is 0, meaning of it is that memory will be selected. Okay, well, all this we have seen. Then ready is another pin, reset in bar. When the device microprocessor is ready, this will go high. After performing some operation, this will go high and it will perform the task. Then reset in bar, when the microprocessor is to be reset, we'll have to keep this pin as 0. And when it is, when the reset operation is over, when the microprocessor is completely reset, this reset out will go high. Okay, for resetting the microprocessor, you'll have to keep this pin, pin number 36, as low. But after complete reset operation, this pin, pin number 3, will become 1. Then the devices will come to know that, okay, the microprocessor is reset now. You can take out the clock from this microprocessor, from this clock out, whatever the clock applied, you can use it for internal purpose. Also, you can use this clock for other purposes. Then hold and hold acknowledge. Many times it is required that the external devices such as memory has to be has to have access with some other external device, okay, without using the microprocessor. In short, the microprocessor has to be bypassed, okay. Microprocessor ko bypass karke, suppose some memory wants to have communication with other devices, okay, in that case this microprocessor 8085 will have to be kept on hold. Means HOLD, this pin, pin number 39, should be high, so that this will be kept on hold, right? And it will complete its internal task, and then hold acknowledge signal will go high after some few seconds. Okay, when HLDA goes high, then that memory will come to know that, okay, the microprocessor is on hold position. And after that, it can interact or communicate with the other devices, for which it will need its data bus or address bus for other operations. Okay, so all these buses will be relinquished. Okay. And they will be spared for the use of other devices when hold signal is received or when microprocessor goes on hold. And lastly, the pin number 40, that is plus VCC. Plus 5 volt is the operating voltage for 8085. Okay. So this is all about pin diagram. Well, this is functional diagram. It is exactly the modified view of various blocks of 8085. You can have everything, every pin is shown over here. But what are the internal blocks? How and where these pins are connected? That is shown over here. There is an accumulator, 8-bit register, temporary register, flags, arithmetic and logic unit, instruction register, instruction decoder, machine cycle, encoding, etc. Then there is a register array. General purpose registers are there, B, C, D, E, H, L. All these are the general purpose registers. Every register is having 8 bits of storage capacity. Then there is a stack pointer, program counter. Program counter is a special type of register which holds the address of the instruction to be executed. Okay, see, as I told you that instructions are written in the memory and every instruction has certain address. So the instruction which is to be executed, its address is first taken into the program counter, I mean microprocessor and program counter, and then its execution is started. Then incrementer decrementer address latch. Okay, further this is the timing and control unit, address bus, data oblique address bus, right? Well, and lastly above, that is interrupt control, serial IO control. This is the interrupt control where INTR or hardware interrupts such as TRAP, RST, 7.5, 6.5, 5.5 are used. Then serial IO control for seed, serial inputting data and output data. Okay, we will stop over here. This is all about for today's session. In fact, now all other details cannot be possible due to say shortage of time. Any other moment of time as and when we meet. We will meet again.
Okay.
Yeah. So thank you very much for being with me. And
okay, thank you, sir.
Well, if there are any one or two questions, I will be able to answer them. If anyone is having those questions, please.
Students, please ask the question. If you have doubt or if any query. Hello.
Hello.
Student, please ask the questions. I think no have any doubt. So thank you very much, sir, for your valuable time.
Yeah, thank you very much. Due to shortage of time, I cannot cover each and everything, but definitely some light will be thrown from my side. I hope so.
Yes sir.
This thrown
definitely, sir. Your guidance is
at least some concepts are cleared as regards to digital electronics, because it requires a lot of say time so as to discuss each and everything in digital electronics. But even then I try to confine it for 1 hour, and in yes, next sir. Hour we have seen the microprocessor 8085, right?
Yes sir. Okay. Definitely, sir. So
thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Thank you. So shall I leave now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So everybody, please give the attendance.
or feedback. Wait a moment. I will circulate the link for the feedback for this workshop. So in the group, so everyone should fill the form in the group. So you left the session now. Okay. Thank you very much, all of you. I will send the link in the group. Okay.